Today we're going to be centering our discussion around Ephesians chapter 5, beginning in verse 15. So if you have your Bible, you might want to turn there. We've been considering chapter 5 of Ephesians, talking about the Christian walk in love, which is laid out for us there, and comparing us in our walk to the walk of Jesus Christ. Now, we've looked so far at things that you do and things that you don't do when you're taking this walk. So today we want to continue our discussion. So let's look at Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. That's Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15 through 21. We're talking about a walk, and so let's pray as we begin. Father, help us as we consider the walk that you have called and appointed us to, that we are being recreated in the image of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we want to be like him. We want to walk like he walked. We want to walk in his steps. So give us grace today, Father, as we consider these things. And help us, Lord, that we might pursue Christ with everything that is within us. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. When we're talking about a walk here, we're talking about attitudes, beliefs, and actions which define the path we take in life. I want us to look today at two different words for this walk, because I'm going to introduce today some things that Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7. When he talked there about the walk, he talked about a journey, a road, a way. That is the Greek word hodos. That is like the root, R-O-U-T-E. Here in chapter 5 of Ephesians, Paul is caught up with the word peripateo, another Greek word which means how you walk. So what we're going to be looking at today is how you walk on the route that has been laid out before us. As Jesus said, it's a narrow way. So, anyone up for a walk? I want to remind us of some things that Paul said. First of all, to Titus in Titus chapter 3, verse 3. For we ourselves were once foolish, disobedient, led astray, slaves to various passions and pleasures, passing our days in malice and envy, hated by others and hating one another. That's how we were. But he says in 1 Thessalonians 5, 5, for you are all children of light, children of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. So, in other words, there are only two paths. The Bible is very specific in pointing out that there are only two paths we can take in life. Only two. These paths, that is to say, a way of living, are, first of all, obedience to the God of the Bible, Jehovah, which is a very narrow way, and two, disobedience to the God of the Bible, which looks like a multifaceted trail because it is so broad and heavy populated. The Bible is very specific, as we looked at last week, at the essentials of a life that imitates God, a life that's characterized by obedience to God. That life is seen as being in love, expressing itself in holiness and sacrifice. So in verses 3 through 6, God shows what disobedience to him looks like, and he instructs us to avoid certain behaviors which are common in the world. So he mentions sexual immorality, impurity, and covetousness, and related filthiness, foolish talk, and crude joking. The warnings connected to these sins are stunning in their severity. No inheritance in the kingdom of God, and the unbridled wrath of God. Those who commit such sins are called the sons of disobedience. They are not dearly loved, as are the children of light. Their words are portrayed as empty, and their realm is described as darkness. The works of these walking in darkness is unfruitful. The things they do are shameful. The injunction for the imitators of God, however, is to walk as children of light, whose fruit is all that is good and right and true. Imitators of God seek to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Those who walk in love show forth the light with an attitude of gratitude. So I want us to hear what Jesus said about this walk and let him weigh in on it. So if you look at Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 through 14, Jesus lays out the proposition that there are only two roads upon which one may walk. Enter by the narrow gate, he said, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. I want to remind you that in Matthew 5 through 7, Jesus, the king, is laying out what he expects his loyal subjects to do and to be like, and shows in contrast what those people who are not loyal subjects look like. So it would stand to reason then that Jesus points out the fruit that is present with those who walk on the road. He says this in verses 15 through 20 of Matthew 7. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will recognize them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? So every healthy tree bears good fruit, but the diseased tree bears bad fruit. A healthy tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a diseased tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Thus you will recognize them by their fruit. So he introduces the idea here that the two different kinds of people who travel those two different kinds of road bear two different kinds of fruit. And then he cautions about being deceived as to which road you have taken. In verses 21 through 23, he says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day many will say to me, 'Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and cast out demons in your name, and do mighty works in your name?' And then I will declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness.'" So here are some who took the broad way but thought they were on the narrow way. And then he discusses the end result of those two roads. He says in verses 24 through 27 of Matthew 7, "Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it." God here in Ephesians 5 is speaking through the Apostle Paul to contrast the two walks in both broad and specific terms. You are either a child of light or a son of disobedience. What's the difference? Faith, or lack of it, in Jesus Christ. The disobedient enjoy darkness and the deeds done in it. So they walk in darkness. That is to say, they reject God's word. The children of light love the light and walk in it. So in our passage today, we see certain contrasts, and I put them there in your notes. On the one hand, we have the children of light. If you look at the children of light, you can see that they use their time well, and they produce good fruit. They discern and embrace the will of the Lord. They are filled with the Spirit, which is seen as singing, that's an outward expression, melody in the heart, that's an inward expression, and they're giving thanks to God always for everything to the Father through the Son and by the power of the Holy Spirit. That's the children of light. But the children of darkness, in contrast, are unwise. They are foolish because they don't understand the will of the Lord. They are drunken, which means they are controlled by substances, things outside themselves, which do them harm. And then debauchery, which is the conduct of people who are walking in darkness. So first, let's look at verse 15 through 16 in chapter 5, where he says, "Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil." In our living of light, then, we are to look carefully, that is to say, be wise, making the most of every opportunity to shine for God. And verse 16 is interesting because the King James translated it, redeeming the time, for the days are evil. The verb exagorazo, which had commercial uses of buy up something, redeem, buy back, figuratively it means to gain something, especially advantage or opportunity, to make the most of it. So that's what that word walking carefully, making best use. In other words, redeeming the time. The Greek has two words for the concept of time. One word is chronos, which is used in reference to the stream of time, and kairos, which is used of individual periods, points, or moments of time. So this verse is referring to taking full advantage of every moment, every kairos, each opportunity which presents itself. The opportunity to do the right thing, to say the appropriate thing, does not come at all times. Those are those teachable moments, those significant times when we're able to watch out and look for and not slip up due to our timidity or our fear. In the Message, Eugene Peterson characterized this verse in this way. He said, "So watch your step, use your head, make the most of every chance you get. These are desperate times." Then I'd like us to look at verses 17 through the first part of verse 18. In other words, be in your right mind and follow the map that's laid out. "Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is, and do not get drunk with wine, for that's debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit." Do not be foolish, Paul continues, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Our standard is not what others do or what we can get away with, but what God's will is. It amazes me how we miss the practical understanding of this. When we moved to Louisville in 1969, it was the first time I'd ever visited that city. The first challenge we faced was to find a place to live that was convenient to the school. We were there so I could attend the University of Louisville. School, shopping, of course, etc. What a challenge! I got lost every time we ventured out because I refused to use the map. That's a picture here. Christ is the map of life. Follow Him. Otherwise, you'll waste time, which I always did when I got lost. So he talks about foolish activities here. Paul's society, as ours, was afflicted with drunkenness as an escape. But alcohol and mind-altering drugs, while facilitating escapism, dull the believers so they can't make the most of every opportunity. Paul isn't a teetotaler. You know, he advised Timothy to take a drink from time to time of wine, which, by the way, would have been 3.5% alcohol, not like today's. But he stands firmly against drunkenness, always. What is drunkenness? A certain blood alcohol level? Well, the problem with intoxication is threefold in this context. First of all, drunkenness leads to something. Paul said what it leads to is debauchery. The New American Standard translates that as dissipation. The Greek word is asotia, the character of asotos, that is, an abandoned man, one that cannot be saved, from not plus sozo, which meant save. So asotia denotes wastefulness, then reckless abandon, debauchery, dissipation, profligacy. So drunkenness leads to moral abandon. It leads people to a place from which they cannot be saved, except, of course, by God's grace and power. Secondly, drunkenness prevents our light from shining. Our goal here is to let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works and bring glory to our Father in heaven. But getting drunk can't do that. In fact, it obscures the light. And then third, drunkenness dulls our ability to look carefully. You know, every year it amazes me, astounds me, how many people are killed by drunken drivers. Why are they killed by these drunken drivers? Because drunken drivers are not in complete control of their faculties. And that's a problem with getting drunk. Your faculties do not allow you to look carefully. They dull you. In Paul's day, drunkenness came primarily from wine and beer. They didn't have distilled spirits in those days, nor did they have marijuana, cocaine, heroin, crack, or speed. They had wine and beer as intoxicants. We are admonished to avoid intoxication. Rather, we are to seek another kind of intoxicant, another kind of high, that is to say, the fullness of the Spirit. So there's the contrast. People who walk in darkness will get intoxicated with something. It dulls their senses. People who walk in the light will get intoxicated with the Holy Spirit, not drunk with wine. And then that brings us to verse 18, be filled with the Spirit. Sometimes people can be so overwhelmed by the presence of the Spirit that they appear intoxicated. In fact, that's what happened on the day of Pentecost. In Acts 2:4, it says that they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And later in chapter 2, verse 13 and 15, others were mocking, saying they are filled with new wine. But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judah and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and give ear to my words. For these people are not drunk as you suppose, since it's only the third hour of the day." They were experiencing a kind of ecstasy, a spiritual buoyancy in the Spirit. Being filled with the Spirit, however, is not always ecstatic. While speaking in languages seem to be associated with ecstasy in Acts 2 and in 1 Corinthians 14, people are told to control themselves and their manifestation of the Spirit. An initial experience with the Spirit is sometimes ecstatic, but once you've learned to include the Spirit and His power in your life, being filled with the Spirit can be wonderful and uplifting and empowering without being ecstatic. Jesus was certainly filled with the Spirit without ecstasy. This is not to say that there may be times that we will be caught up in ecstasy before the Lord. And when that happens, all I say is, enjoy the Lord. But what does being filled with the Spirit do exactly? Well, look at verses 19 through 20. Addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. The kind of spirit intoxication of which Paul speaks of here in Ephesians 5 involves worship and mutual spiritual upbuilding. Psalms. We're singing the Psalter, the book of Psalms, which was written to be sung and was sung by the Jews in Paul's day. Hymns. Probably had a religious significance as a technical term for festive psalms of praise, much like we'd say, you know, praise hymns, praise choruses today, or for liturgical calls or recitations. Group members were encouraged to each bring a hymn or some other contribution from the Spirit when the believers gathered in order to build up one another. That's 1 Corinthians 14:16. Spiritual songs may have been more spontaneous, perhaps like Paul singing in the Spirit of 1 Corinthians 14:15. Though the lines between psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs are not firmly drawn, they appear to be three distinct things that were praise and worship to the Lord God Almighty. Notice the effect that songs had on one another. Verse 19a, first part of verse 19, focuses on the effect. The second part of verse 19 looks at our musical worship as it relates to God. So the manner of these Spirit-filled praises is always God-oriented, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. An attitude of thankfulness underlies all true worship. In fact, I'll say to you that you never can truly be worshiping the Lord out of a heart that's filled with anything other than gratitude to the Lord. This section points out and spells out the joyful intimacy of walking with the Lord, the relationship we enjoy with our Father and with our Christ. So notice, please, he exhorts us in verse 1 to imitate the Father as beloved children. In verse 8, he says, live as children of light. In verse 10, he says, learn what pleases the Lord and then do it. And then here in 19, he talks about making music in our hearts to the Lord. And in verse 20, he talks about thanking God continually, always, in everything. But that introduces a point to this whole thing. He's heading to a point which we're going to elaborate on beginning next week. He says to submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. The next section that we'll look at beginning next week talks about submission. Now, this is going to be where the rubber meets the road. Because, you know, too often, especially in Texas, we feel all big and bad because we feel like we can solve all of our problems and do everything. But actually, we need one another to do that. And the key to that is learning how to submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Notice, it is to one another, and it is out of reverence for Christ. Well, how can we apply our passage today? Let me give you three things. The first one is in the form of a question. Are you following the map? That is to say, are you imitating God in Christ? Are you looking at Jesus Christ and seeing how he walked and then walking in the manner that he walked? That's following the map. That is the peripeteia, what we're supposed to be doing. Do the things that Jesus did. Do the things that you know that Jesus would want you to do. And then walk that road, that hodas, that leads to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So, peripeteia, imitate Christ as you're walking on the hodas. Secondly, which do you enjoy most, the direct route or getting lost? I think sometimes as Christians we waste so much time because we get off the road because we don't watch our walk on a daily basis. We think, well, I'm just walking along. I'm a Christian. I'm doing what I need to do. But, you know, in retrospect, when you look back on it, can you ask yourself some hard questions and say, how was my walk this day? How was my walk yesterday? Did it reflect my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ? Was I walking as a child of light? Or was I walking differently than I should have? Did I get a little lost out here? The direct route, my friends, is always the best use of time, the best use of resources. Third, are you walking in truth or deception? It may seem liberating to go your own way, you know, but it's fatal. You know, here's a case in which it's possible to be deceived. And I know it's possible because Jesus said so in Matthew chapter 7. There were many people who at the end of days are going to look at him and say, we did all of this for you. And he's going to say, I didn't know you. So are you walking this walk that you're walking every day in truth, or are you deceived? Well, you say, how would you know if you're deceived? Well, first of all, if you get away from God's word, you're deceived. Second of all, if you're listening too much to other people who are not like-minded people in the Christian faith, who are not brothers and sisters in the Lord, it's possible to get deceived. Jesus points out that a big deception is false teachers. Are you listening to false teachers? Teachers who are not plugged into the Word of God and teaching the raw, bare Word of God. If you are, you may be being deceived. Let me come back here to the point of this message. We've been called to a certain kind of walk as Christians. And that walk is a walk that is an imitating of Jesus Christ, through Jesus Christ, to God the Father in a way that is pleasing to Him. And so He warns us what that would be like. It's a walk of love that's characterized by sacrifice. Or another kind of walk is a walk that's characterized by debauchery. All those sins that are named. It's time to take an inventory. What's your walk like? What are you looking like every day? Oh, this is not just like, what do people think of me? No, you can get anybody to tell you something nice about yourself. This is, what does Christ think of me? What does God the Father think of my life? What would His analysis be of the walk that I am walking? Is it walking as a child of light, imitating our Father in heaven, through Jesus Christ the Son, by the power of the Spirit? Or are we doing our own thing? Let me caution, doing your own thing won't cut it. Doing your own thing probably means you're deceived. But if you can honestly look at it and say, I rejoice that God has put me on this path, this hodos, this narrow way. I rejoice that along this way He has told me how I am to conduct myself and how I'm to lock arms with my brothers and my sisters and in submission to one another because of love for Christ. We take this journey together. We walk this road together and we can help one another as we go. That's a life we've been called to. That's a life worth living. Let's pray. Father, help us that we will walk not as unwise but as wise. Help us, Lord, that we will follow our Christ, gloriously so, Father. We love everything about Him, Lord. We love Him to the end of all things. We love Him on into eternity, Father. We love Him because He first loved us. Oh, Father, help us to be faithful and true and loyal to You. And help us to follow our God and King, Jesus Christ, who gave Himself for us. For it's in His name we pray. Amen.